them off right now. Not even vibrate, turn them all the way off, right? This is a live performance, so our actors are up here doing this right in front of you, and noises, talking,
chips,
candy, this all distracts from the performance for them. Makes it more difficult. So if you can please certainly enjoy the show, have fun with the show, but keep those kinds of noises down. That would be much appreciated. Other than that, sit back, relax, and enjoy some theater.
You know what? I should tell her where your wife was 2 weeks ago.
See, but I'm not.
father all in her life, and she just does this stupid stuff all the time.
What you talking about, man? She a good daddy over here.
Man, skip that, man. Listen, Jimmy. You know what? You know what? Just tell her to reapply for the position underneath the title. I'm gonna do her job.
Hey, man, why don't you just tell her? She talking about you got kids. You talking about people losing their jobs. Just tell her.
I don't have any kids. You know that, man. I'm here. I'm about to go, man. I'm gonna talk to you later.
Whatever, man. Damn.
What's up?
Hey, man, y'all some straight bullshit. We supposed to be guys, but I'm gonna call him back right now.
Man, look, because I ain't got time for that. I need to get up to the school and meet up with some guys.
Hey, man, look, we supposed to be homies. I don't care if you graduate or not.
Hey, I got this letter I need you to give to him. It's from my advisor.
Hey, whatever it is, you can give it to yourself.
Calm down. This letter from my advisor, Rabbit.
Hey, man, he ain't answering, but what you say?
Yeah, I thought that'd catch your attention. She told me she went to college with you two. Lick 'em low lovers, whatever that means. I told her, you don't get any women. And Jerome too busy looking for Mrs. Perfect. She gotta have her own two cats.
Anyway, Rabbit is ill academic advisor. We ain't seen nothing she left to get that abortion.
Yeah, while Jerome's up here cracking jokes, I forgot to tell her. I went up to my school yesterday and seen a little boy up there. With a chick who looked like she was 17 or 18 years old. The little boy could pass for his twin.
What, you trying to tell me Jerome got a kid with a chick who's barely 18?
I don't know. All I do know is this chick, Rachel, told me to get this letter to Jerome and tell you the king of living low love. She said, what's up?
Hey, cut that out, man. Who was in college, boy?
Now, whatever. I got to get up to this school. And I text Tough Gal. He said, I'll be meet up later.
All right, that's all I want to hear. Hey, I'm glad you're doing the right thing.
Hey, man, get real. I keep you all too safe out on these streets.
Forever. My radio.
What up, boy?
What up, brother? Almost killed the pimp.
My friend called me over here. What's up?
Hey, man, tell out who's true. Fix up a shot or something.
Fix me a drink, man. That's my jam right here.
I ain't so amazed, but fix me a drink.
Come on, bro. I'm your guest, man. Talk to brother, man.
Is she coming, son?
Why should come over here, man? What's the big deal, man? I'm not talking to her anymore.
Hello, Jerome. I know hearing from me must be a surprise since we haven't seen or talked to each other in almost 10 years. I'm as shocked as you are, and I have been ever since Casanova walked into my office needing help. She was too drunk to remember meeting me that night in college, but that's okay because I remembered her in the most heart-dropping way. I thought the world was spinning off its axis. I know she thought I was overwhelmed by her looks the way she glared at me. Well, the reason I'm writing to you is because I have a regretful secret to share with you. We have a son. When I went back home that semester, my mother found out I was pregnant and made me have the baby. You're just finding out now, partly because I was really, really scared, and also my mom was like, I needed to finish college instead of running around looking for some guy who more than likely had 4 or 5 kids anyway. I told her, no, you weren't like that, but she made me stay home anyway. If Casanova didn't say, or maybe she didn't see him, but my little niece was keeping him and dropped by the school when she came by my office. Anywho, we'll be back this Monday, so please call me or come by and you can see your son. And I'm so, 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 so sorry. Rachel, AKA Rabbit.
Man, what? You got a shorty?
as shocked as you. A kid? What am I gonna do with the kid?
Man, cat out the bag, homie. That's what you've been looking for. You, if anybody, wanna be somebody's dad.
Man, this is crazy. And now I gotta wait all the way to Monday to see my child?
Hey man, we happy for you. And we gonna help you out. Come on, man. Baby, man. Let me get some love. Bring it in, bring it in.
This is some bullshit. What you mean I don't look good? I'm fat as hell.
You are amazing.
Can't wait to get home.
Until he gets what he wants from you.
Steve is not like that. He's different. advice.
Why are you so nervous?
I'm not. I just have some things on my mind.
Like what?
Oh, things.
Talk to me, Sherry. What should we buy?
Well, about us taking our relationship a little further. And about this ex-girlfriend.
What's bothering you about that?
Steve, I don't think you've been honest with me about her. And if I'm gonna put myself to you, I need for you to be honest with me.
Sherry, I told you have nothing to worry about. She is not an issue. And I love you.
I'm afraid of what's gonna happen after we have sex.
I don't understand, Sherry. What are you saying?
Will you feel the same way about me after we have sex?
Hey, Sherry, you decided, what are you gonna do? Sherry, when it's all said and done, it's your decision.
How do you know when you're ready to have sex?
What's to know? Both want each other, right?
Sherry, he loves Steve and he loves you. You know, the raise you get, the chemistry, your heart beats fast, you get butterflies.
Look, Sherry, if you have to think about it, then you're not really ready, boo.
I know I love Steve and I don't want to lose him.
Lose him? So what? There's like a bajillion guys up here. If you have to have sex with Steve to show Steve that you love him, then that's not really love, girl.
If I don't have sex with Steve, I'm afraid he'll break up with me.
Good. Okay, don't get tired of this conversation.
Steve, if he loves you and respects you, he'll wait for you.
Thank you.
Sherry, we need to talk.
About what, Steve?
You know I love you.
Yes, I know.
This is gonna be hard for me to say.
Just say what you have to say, Steve.
We need to wake up.
Where's Steve? How did you do me like this?
I told you. Next. Sherry, maybe he's going through something right now.
Look, keep your head up. If he doesn't see how wonderful you are, he's a loser anyway.
He was probably bad in bed anyway, right? I mean, there's going to be another guy coming over him any minute. Especially because, you know, you're no longer a virgin and everything.
If love is what you seek, then love is what you should find.
Hey, Sherry. Sherry, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt you.
You're sorry? Is that all you can say is that you're sorry? I finally decided to give myself to you, and you tried to break my heart?
I didn't mean for this to happen.
But why, Steve? Why? You're not making any sense at all.
Well, my ex-girlfriend wanted to get back with me, and I still have feelings for her.
But you said I didn't have to worry about her. You said that she was not an issue. You said that you would never hurt me.
I know I hurt you, and I'm sorry. Can we please go somewhere and talk?
Why, Steve? Why now? Why is it so important that we go and talk now?
My ex-girlfriend didn't want to get back with me. She just wanted to see if she could get back with me.
And so now you want me to be with you?
Yes.
I don't know, Steve. You hurt me pretty bad. I don't think I can go through that again.
Sherry, you have to trust me. I know what I did was wrong. But I love you, Sherry. And I promise I will never hurt you again.
About how he survived driving down the wrong side of the expressway while intoxicated, while another friend often tells us how she was pulled from a vehicle that flipped over several times. She was also driving while intoxicated. Starting Over is a story about a young man whose life was turned upside down by a careless mistake. This story is dedicated to the boys in the hood and brothers and sisters everywhere who are on lockdown, going through something, struggling with an alcohol or drug addiction, or simply trying to make a difference.
Buck Wild was a typical wannabe player from the hood. On this particular August afternoon, Buck was about to be released from prison, and the only thing that he could think about was how nice it would be to see his parents, his son, Little Man, and his girlfriend, Sweet Peaches. While he was on lockdown, Buck made a promise to himself that he would change his life and reclaim his family. His first stop was his parents' house. The entire family was there. His mom, dad, sister, brothers, aunts, uncles, and cousins were all there, and they showered Buck with love, and they treated him to a lavish welcome home dinner. Buck really enjoyed the turnout, but he couldn't understand why Sweet Peaches and Lil Man were not present. Buck asked his family about Sweet Peaches and Lil Man, but no one seemed to know what happened to them. The rumors had it that Sweet Peaches was tired of Buck's crazy antics, and that she and Lil Man ran off with some guy who could give her the life that she always wanted. Buck was extremely upset when he heard the rumors, and he made up his mind that he would find Sweet Peaches at any cost. So Buck called all Sweet Peaches' old friends. Buck made a dozen or more calls all around the city, but Sweet Peaches was nowhere to be found. Finally, out of desperation, Buck decided to call Susie Q, one of Sweet Peaches' closest friends. Susie and her daughters had moved out to the West Coast, and she was surprised to hear from Buck. The two had a long, friendly conversation about the old days. From the sound of it, Susie was chilling on the beach because Buck could hear the roar of the ocean in the background, some children laughing, and classical music playing on the portable radio. Suddenly, Buck remembered how Sweet Peaches and Susie both shared the love for children and classical music. He also recalled how Sweet Peaches often tried to persuade him to give up the wild parties and his thuggish attitude for a more cultured lifestyle. But Buck was stubborn, and he simply ignored Sweet Peaches' advice. The conversation was very cordial, but unfortunately, Susie didn't have a clue about Sweet Peaches' whereabouts. Sweet Peaches was nowhere to be found, and Buck needed a place where he could kick back and compose himself. Buck loved the outdoors, and he remembered that his favorite spot was a cozy little wooded area just outside the city. So Buck jumped on the bus and ran out to the park to unwind. While he was in the park, Buck looked up and saw some children in a nearby playground. The children were all giggly with laughter as their swings flew high in the sky. The scene reminded Buck of the times that he and Sweet Peaches will take Little Man out to the park to play with the other children. It made Buck feel sad and empty inside when he realized that he had missed out on some of the most important years of Little Man's life. Buck looked up in the sky and he noticed a full moon overhead. He realized that it was getting late, but he was too tired to take the long trip back home. So Buck simply lay back on the bed of grass and stared up at the moon. As the memories of his past began to flow through his mind, then Buck closed his eyes and fell fast asleep.
You are nowhere to be found.
Almost immediately, Buck began to dream of the day his life fell apart. The wild parties, the drugs, and his crazy macho behavior. Buck could see himself with his friends, Crack House and 40 Ounce, with a fifth of cognac in one hand and a blunt in the other, getting wasted all night and sometimes passing out in the middle of the street. Buck could also remember how the rush from the drugs and alcohol made him feel like he was some kind of supernatural being that could soar through the sky like a bird on a cloud of magic dust. That day, his world came crashing down.
You're my reflection, so tell me, why can't you be?
Drugs had a weird side effect, and Buck started hallucinating about things that wasn't even there. When Buck came to, he found himself behind the wheel of a stolen vehicle that had somehow crashed in the brick wall. All he could remember is that a pedestrian died in the accident and his two best friends lost their lives. Somehow, he had survived. Buck's carelessness cost him 10 years of his life and he felt like dying. But God had given Buck a second chance and this time, he wasn't going to blow. Buck felt something on his shoulder. His eyes flew open. When he looked up, there stood Sweet Peaches and his son. Sweet Peaches told Buck that she was living in a shelter on the north side of town. Every day, she would come out to the park because it reminded her so much of him. Buck jumped up and the three of them embraced. Under the light of the full moon, Buck looked into their eyes and vowed that he would change his life forever.
This goes out to you.
This goes out to you, yeah.
You are sort of like a diamond in time.
Yeah.
Every day is the end of feels like the first day. This is dedicated to you.
Thank you.
use this gun.
Hello?
plan on my way back home.
What? What?
Yes. I am her mother.
What happened to Keisha?
They say she's in the hospital.
What?
No. 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 No.
Mama, what really happened?
Mama,
what really happened?
No.
Mama, what really happened?
They killed my baby. They killed my pumpkin.
What? Mama, your day is my birthday, for goodness sake! Don't you raise your voice at me!
We forgot to talk about how we didn't even think about the time. I'm tripping. Don't lose that straight talking, Mama. You can trim down the hair and all that again.
You know I don't have any money, don't Mama?
Go say what it said last night.
It was late. And I didn't want to wake you, so I had to come and take it to Veronica's suite.
Child, don't you stand there and let me.
Mama, why do you always want to believe the worst about me? You have to have your dirty thoughts, don't you?
Have you lost your mind talking to me like that? You've been smoking on funny cigarettes. I said you never want that stuff into my house.
Give me that.
Now I know you own something.
I don't know anything.
What you got in that pocketbook on that?
Nothing.
Then why can't I look and say?
Because I deserve some kind of privacy.
Not in my house, you don't. I'll give you 3 seconds to give me that pocketbook. One time.
Wait, listen.
No, you listen.
Two? Here. But you're wrong, Mom. I'm not anything.
You must be on something, staying on all night, coming in sassy. Me? I
told you it's nothing in here. Always.
Hold it! What is that?
What is what?
Well, I may be old, but I am not that. I know I saw something that. Some kind of pills and something that looked like a package of balloons.
Mama, I don't know what you're talking about.
I'm talking about those birth control pills. Maybe it's that new stuff.
What new stuff?
Do you know that stuff that's supposed to help skinny little poor man like your sneaky looking boyfriend come more potent?
That's it. I can't have this conversation.
No, you don't, sister. Not till I see what's in that pocketbook.
All right. All right. What you saw was my headache. It's not better for my doctor.
Listen. I was born at night, but not last night. I called you to deliver me right in my room. You looked me right in the eye.
It was my birthday yesterday, Mama. And I decided to do some of the things that I like to do.
Really?
Hey.
Like smoking reefer and acting like a whore.
Don't you say that, Mama! Don't you say that!
Oh, now I know you have lost your mind.
bag.
Stop lying, because I saw him when I was in here looking for my stolen bag.
You've been pretending to look for your stolen bag, Mama. Why do you always have to spy on me? Why can't you just trust me?
I trusted you last night. Where did your mom have to go?
Did y'all go to a motel?
Mama!
Is that why you got that Viagra in that pocket?
Oh,
sweetheart. I married her right after we graduated. The next day, in fact. Right before I got drafted. Look, I never made love to another woman, touched one, or even smelled another lady. She was my life, my everything. You know how they say that a woman completes a man? Well, she ain't complete me, boss. She made me. That woman made me a man. I remember when we bought our first house. She was so excited. She kept ranting and raving about how she was gonna decorate the bathroom and paint our bedroom walls rose petal pink. I said, Regina, what a man like me look like sleeping in a pink room? You wanna know what she said to me? I guess you just plan on sitting there looking pretty all day, huh?
Oh, baby, you wouldn't want a pretty guy like me to break a nail now, would you? Besides, I have work to do. That bathroom is my project, and I'ma pretty it up to my liking.
So does that mean I get to decorate this room? Cause I got some posters I'ma put on the wall right there. The TV, it can go right here in front of the bed. And brown will look great on these walls, don't you think?
Brown? I think that you should leave the decorating to me. This room would be perfect painted pink. Rose pink, to be exact. It'll look dainty. Nice and dainty.
Dainty, Gina? What a man like me look like sleeping in a pink, dainty room?
You know what you look like, baby? You look like the husband of Regina Glass Cady. And there's only one man that can say that. Now, ain't that right?
I have this dance.
It's just me and you, baby. No one else but me and you. Remember that. Don't leave me anymore.
I ain't never left you, baby. We were happy for a long time. She was my wife for 6 years. My girlfriend for 2 before that. Look, she was my best friend, my confidant, my lover, my companion. She was almost my mother, too, it seems like. Then we got pregnant. Regina and I were both so excited for the baby to come. I would do any and everything for that woman. She wouldn't have to lift a finger. She would just sit and make booties and hats for him all day long. Blue. His room was painted blue. Blue like the deep blue sea. She wanted the color of blue like the sky in the middle of June. You remember what that looked like, boss? Because I don't. I don't remember what June looks like anymore.
I'm making another hat for Junior. He's really gonna like this one because it's going to say Daddy's Little Slugger on it. Right on the front.
Daddy's little slugger, all right. Daddy's slugger the reason he's on his way. Grab some takeout on the way home. You've been craving this corned beef hash, so I figured I'd bring you something back.
Thank you, honey. You can put it right there on the table. I want to talk to you about something. I want you to paint his room blue, baby. I want it to be a light blue. Blue like the sky in June.
Now that goes a color I can agree on, blue. I think it should be a more manly blue though. It needs to grow up to be a working man, Jane. Not to get lost in his dreams under the June sky.
Well, right now, Ronald, we don't have to worry about all that. Junior has been causing some trouble in my stomach.
That stupid bitch killed my baby! You know what it feels like to lose someone you love? That slut killed our little man. What was she knitting all this shit for anyway if she knew she was gonna kill our baby? He was gonna be a junior, boss. When Junior died, he took a part of me with him. You're not looking at Ronald Casey. You're looking at half of him. I'm half of Ronald Casey. Now I'll never get the other half back.
What do you mean that you're only half of Ronald Casey?
Look, if you cut a circle in half, it ain't a circle no more, is it? I mean, it's sort of like a crescent, or maybe a letter C, but whatever it is, it ain't a circle. You can't sit in half a chair. If you do, you're gonna fall. You can't drive half a car, you can't walk with half a body, and you damn sure can't be half a man. I ain't a man no more. I don't know what I am, but without you, I ain't a man. Baby, please, stay calm, baby. Paramedics are on their way. Please, I just need for you to stay calm.
Oh, God.
God is watching over us. He is not gonna let nothing happen to his feet.
Julia, don't leave like this. Don't leave your mom in there like this.
Stop talking crazy, Virginia. Ain't nothing gonna happen to this baby. I just need for you to stay calm. Can you do that for me? We were never the same after that. I was drafted 2 months after the abortion. I was overseas for 2 years before they discharged me early. I was talking to people that wasn't even there. They had me going to see hair doctors and whatnot, and they sent me home. I ain't mad because I wanted to be with my wife. But the first day I was home, Regina didn't say more than 3 words to me. The next day was the same. It got to the point where I was missing my wife, and she was laying right next to me. Have you ever missed someone that was right next to you?
I can't say that I have, Mama.
Well, I have. I did it every day and every night. Then she started going crazy on me, talking about how she thought the war never left me and I should see the doctor. Then, for the next few months, she would talk about this man named Troy who came home with me from the war. I told her, Regina, look, I don't know no man named Troy. Ain't no Troy been here. I wasn't home for more than a year before I lost her.
Troy came by here today, Ronnie. I told you to make sure he stayed far, far away from me.
Baby, what are you talking about? Once again, dog, there's no friend of mine named Troy. Do we need to visit the doctor?
Do you need to visit the doctor again? Baby, you need help. I love you so much, and I would never leave you, but you need help.
Regina, stop talking crazy now, girl. I'm telling you about this damn Troy.
Well, then snap out of it, baby. God. If you love me, then Troy would not exist anymore. Baby, I'm tired. I'm tired of being beat up, of being cussed at, of being torn apart.
Who been hitting you? I kill him, Zinda. I kill him cold. Ain't nobody gonna mess with you.
Ronald, give me a gun.
Who the fuck is Ronald, bitch? You been fucking around on me? You been saying all this with Ronald? Get on your knees and say I'm sorry, Troy. Now! You want the gun, baby? Say I'm sorry, Troy. And I love
you. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm sorry, Troy. I love you so much.
Now, I love you so much, Regina. But you don't love me back. You love Ronald. You ain't never loved me. You love Ronald.
Are you not aware that you've been diagnosed with dissociative identity disorder? You are right. Troy did kill your wife. But you are Troy, Mr. Casey. You murdered your wife, and I need you to comprehend that, or we cannot move forward with transferring you from confinement.
I did not kill my wife! This is your business! Y'all trying to keep me here! I did not kill my wife! Stop blinding me! I did not kill my wife! Stop blinding me! I did not kill my wife!
Patient number 138543, 50-year-old Ronald Casey, has been a patient here at Hawks Mental Institution for 15 years. He has been diagnosed with DID, also known as multiple personality disorder. Casey does not recall the murder of his wife, nor does he recall who Troy is. After evaluation of his fourth appeal, he is not ready to be transferred and will remain in confinement until another appeal is entered.
Want your children to take good care of them. And this whole episode is one you rarely have to think about.
You think I have no feelings for my child?
You're the only one saying it was conceived by force.
Mr. Brown, I don't think you understand. When I had Dean, I wasn't ready for a child. Neither was my husband.
But you were married.
That didn't make me ready. We were scared, even though we were convinced that we're going to build a better life for ourselves and our children.
Mommy, you and Daddy gave me a wonderful life.
That's nice of you to say. But you know, I've been thinking. I spent a lot of time raising you to be as good as a dove and not as wise as a serpent.
Mrs. Barnes, you've done a fine job raising your daughter. Obviously, it's been a little hard. You shouldn't consider this your failure.
Believe me, I don't. The failure's on George. He's the one dodging his responsibilities.
This may surprise you, Mrs. Barnes, but I agree with you, mostly. That's why I believe the correct course of action at this juncture is for Dina to have the baby if she wants a say in where the baby's delivered.
What makes you think I was raised to give away my child? Esther!
Honey, I didn't raise you to have this baby by this animal here.
Hey, stop it. I think I understand George. He may be a little immature, a prisoner of raging hormones, but he's no more animal than Dina, or you, or I. Where is your understanding?
I don't owe George any understanding.
Mama, whether you like it or not, he's the father of your first grandchild.
Do you think that you can just declare a family? Stop acting like Little Red Riding Hood. Open your eyes. That there is a wolf. George is a sperm donor. He's not a baby's daddy.
Stop. I'm gonna let you talk about George that way.
What about my daughter? What about Dina?
This may surprise you. And once upon a time, I wasn't George. Bullied into a marriage that was a disaster. You want to know why I opened this clinic? You want to know my dreams? I want to help young people steer away from both disasters. Help them avoid an abortion that would condemn them to a life of regret. Help them avoid a marriage that they're not ready for and just don't understand.
Aren't you just dumping your experience on us? George is not like you. He just wants what he wants.
Well, a young man's dreams can turn to dust awfully easily.
So can a mother's and a daughter's.
Mama, I was there too. Maybe I was trying to get pregnant. I don't think I was, but maybe. Maybe I thought he cared as much as I did.
You don't
have to. Why do you keep saying that? Is everything you taught me just pretend? The same with you. You think every pregnant woman is the same. It's like writing on a blackboard. And if you don't like it, just wait a while and erase it.
Well, you know, sometimes we make decisions that we hate.
I thought he cared about me. I thought he'd be there for me.
You're wrong.
I guess I'm wrong.
Look, I'm not sure I want you making all the decisions about my kid.
Your kid?
George, are you saying you now accept the allegation?
Do you admit you raped her?
I didn't rape her, but I am father.
You just want to follow your dreams before you settle down with us, with our baby and me.
No. You and I and that baby are never going to be together as a family. I'm not an adoption.
George! You are a cruel man. And one day, you're gonna reap what you sow.
I'm starting to see where you're coming from. George only wants to be a part of this
child. Our child.
This child's life. It's ways that only make problems.
Then you don't have to have this baby.
Why do you keep saying that? Why don't you all just shut up? This is not your jigsaw puzzle to piece together. Mr. Browning, you want me to give my baby away. Mama, you want me to be some sweet, innocent thing that never loved a man. But I'm not. I'm not interested in any of your ideas. I don't care. This is my life and it's my child.
Dina, we're just trying to come to the best solution here.
Your resolution is like wrapping paper. You just want me to give my baby to some nice couple.
Do you know the trouble you're setting yourself up for?
I don't, but I have to be me. Maybe I should be more shrewd like a serpent, but I'm not.
What about George?
I struggle with him, but I can. I'm strong and getting stronger.
I still think we have options, Mrs. Barnes. Dina, when you've had time to think it over, the clinic will still be here, and George might come around.
George will have to do whatever George is going to do.
Are you sure you know what you're going to do?
How could I be? I know enough to remember every woman who wasn't ready for
the child born in her, like my own mother. I can learn from them and draw their strength when I need to. This is a long journey I'm on, but it's my journey.
What? Who said what?
That's my keys. I don't know who
called me and said my son named Ron has been shot and he's dead.
What is your name, miss?
My name is Karen Thomas.
Yes, who's your son?
How do you know it's my son that's been shot? Where's the body?
He was your son, ma'am, and I believe they took him to the Cook County Morgue because he was pronounced dead at the scene.
What is your name?
Officer White.
How you gonna tell me I own a body that I can't even see? You don't know me from Evelyn Smith, whoever she is.
Look, he's yours, ma'am, and if you have any more questions, feel free to call the officer.
Say goodbye to all the ones I love so dear. It would have been nice to say thanks again to all who brought me cheer. It would have been nice, especially, Mom, to say goodbye to you and just to thank you for all the years and the tears and the love you gave so truly.
Oh God, why did I have to bury him?
You have to forgive the person who killed your son.
Not now! Give it 2 weeks! Give it 2 months! The wall is still wrong!
If you don't forgive him, I can't forgive you.
Oh, God! I don't know if I can! But I choose to. Will you help me? Lord, if it's you, they're gonna have to rearrange this courtroom. Cause I don't see how I can get to the judge and ask him if I could sing my song.
Where I'm from, no one makes it.
Everyone settles for the blue-collar life. We started fucking off at 12, 13, drinking, smoking herb, and that pretty much became all that we did. Dude, you wanna come on by, twist one up, roast a couple balls, get ripped? Or you wanna get a 40, maybe a ball, and get jacked as fuck? Maybe we just get some boomers. Make some mushroom tea, get that nice full body in it. I felt threatened. In the neighborhood, working dead-end jobs, there was no way to get out. Now, I don't know if you smoke pot, but when you're a full-blown stoner, you're high all day, every day. And everyone has their rituals. For me, it's dumping out the ashtray. I have to have a full bottle of water and a full bag of Stonies and a bag of Bud to last all night. That way I don't have to answer my phone. I don't have to get up to get the door. Shit, I don't have to do anything for that matter. Just chill out, get that nice little warm, toasty feeling. Kick back and play some BG. Melt. I'm working 40 hours a week. Not a dead end jobs for no long. Jiffy Lube, janitor, landscaping, telemarketing, mag groceries. Hell, I even worked at a 7-Eleven. And then I was working at the liquor store. And the manager from this bar down the street would always come in. And I'd be like, come on, man. Hook me up, I'm a good kid, just give me a shift. No shifts. I got no shifts, kid. And then one day, how about Fridays, kid? Want to do Fridays? So now it's like you're the fucking man. Because when you're on that side of the bar, you're just a regular guy. You're standard fucking asshole trying to get laid. But when you're behind the bar, you're mixing the drinks. You don't even have to try. Now they tell you to have a few cocktails on the job, that way you can loosen up a little bit. And the drunks don't feel like they're drinking alone. 30 minutes into my shift, Wired Mike comes in. Now, if she wanted to be beautiful, she could be beautiful. And if she wanted to be sexy, you knew she could be sexy. She even had a cute voice, bubbly personality. She knew how to manipulate me. The girl was like a drug to me. I think that's where my problem started off getting even worse. She liked to do it so much, now I'm doing it all the time. So I had to set rules for myself. I used to like to call them the coke rules. I could only do it on the weekends, and I can't do it back-to-back nights. That way you're only doing it one day a week. Less than 2 months? No, those rules are gone. All right, new rule. I can only do it on days that I work. Yeah, that snapped right away. Good call, Junior. Now my brother, he hated this girl. He knew what she was all about. Fuck, he still hates her. Now my brother, kid works harder than anyone I know. Just a good kid, never fucked with drugs. He's my top dog all time right there. He's 2.5 years younger than me. And we always believed in each other for everything we did. He never knew I didn't cope. I don't know how I kept it hidden from him for so long. My nickname was Bumble Stiltskin. It's a Saturday night. Things are going good. Me, this girl, all of my friends throwing down, straight up fucking rage fest. You know what I mean? I decided to go to the bathroom. Do myself a little blast of a Belushi. And I'm chopping it up on the windowsill. I hear the door open. I don't think anything of it. And I hear June. Now June is what my brother is. My stomach fucking drops. Oh fuck, I gotta get myself out of this fucking situation. I mean, this is it, I'm fucking busted. And it's worse than getting pimped by the cops. June, what are you doing in there? I just start wiping down coke off the window so fast that I can't get coke off my hands. Ah, some scumbags just left some shit in here. I was just cleaning it up. And that was it. I was the scumbag. I was the piece of shit. I was lying to everybody. My mom and dad. Even my own brother. And that was where I stopped. Gotta thank the good Lord for that one. I said, fuck it. I'm getting my shit together. I'm turning my life around. No regrets, no goodbyes. I moved out to Colorado. I cleaned myself up. And now I'm back home. In Chicago, baby!